Hey there, Mr. Reddit here. Welcome back to another episode of r/EntitledParentStories. Our first story we'll be reading today. Give my son the candy he's allergic to. After that, entitled mom demands I help because I apparently work at a trampoline park. After that, you have the wrong number. And after that, my house shares a similar address to a local retail store. Now Karen told me if we can get 1,000 likes on this video, she won't give entitled kid any more candy he's allergic to for an entire week. So please smash that like button. And if you're new, subscribe and turn on notifications for new stories from Reddit every single day. And huge shout out to our newest official members of the Re Army, Antiseptic Eye, Bookish, and William Smith. Thank you so much for supporting the channel. Join as an official channel member today, and I'll give you a special shout out in our next video. Give my son the candy he's allergic to. Backstory. This involved a mother that literally tried to give her brat candy that he was allergic to. I was 16 at the time. Sweet 16, got a new job from my bagger job, and I worked at a candy store. I loved seeing the kids run in, greet me, and then beg their parents for some sugary treats. Let me quickly hop onto this story. Our cast. We've got me. We've got entitled mom. We've got entitled Brad. Let's call him Billy. The story. I got this job not long after I quit my bagger job. I thought to myself, hey, this sounds super fun. Let me try it out. So I did. Next thing you know, I'm working there. I loved, loved, loved my job. I met so many great people, had some nice conversations with them, and I was working pretty well with my coworkers. I worked Mondays, Thursdays, Fridays, and the weekends to gather as much money as possible for upcoming friends' birthdays, family birthdays, Christmas, all that nice stuff. So I worked hard, been kind, and always had a smile on my face. But I have a short temper, and I hate dealing with entitled people, brats, jerks, stuck-up snobs, and so forth. Most of my workers know that they should not get into an argument with me, but that never happens. I'm too nice, they told me. Can't wait to prove them wrong with this story. Now, I have dealt with a lot of dumb people during my 3 years working at the candy store. I really didn't like some people either. There was this group that would always come in and try to steal. We'd always catch them before they got banned, finally, after they tried to steal a massive jawbreaker. That thing was huge, bigger than my head. But my job was fun nonetheless. I worked with two other people. Let's call them Apple and Caramel. Apple and Caramel were siblings who I hung out with. And by the way, just between you and me, I only named them this because Apple was sour but sweet, while Caramel was sweet in general. Oh, and I was hungry for caramel apples during this time. Our manager, Ben, was very strict about our rules, and he didn't tolerate foolery in the workplace. But he was protective of his coworkers, mostly over his own son, who worked there as well, Chad. It was me and Caramel. Chad was in the back of the store. It was a lazy day, not too many customers, which is understandable. It was a Tuesday after all. I was hanging around with Caramel, and we were both playing 8-ball on our phones when we heard a small tinkle noise. Enter Karen with her annoying, screaming son, Billy. We hopped up quickly and looked. Caramel walked out to greet them, smiling. Karen gave her a look and ignored her. She was looking around with a kinda nasty look and rolled her eyes. We heard her scoff. The kid, who looked to be like 5, was staring around at all the candy, hungry as ever. We heard him cry, "Mommy, I want the candy!" Next thing you know, she released Billy onto us, cause I guess she didn't want to deal with him anymore. Billy ran around, wiping his tears and screaming, causing such a ruckus in the store. Then he sees it. The walls of candy. His little hands tried to grab the nearby jawbreakers. They were the most popular. But in the process, he dropped one and it broke. Me, worried for his safety. "Hey, get away from that wall, it's dangerous." The candy on the wall has dispensers, but most of our candy, you either put on a glove and put it into a bag, or you use a pair of tongs to go ahead and grab it. I also didn't want him near it because for sanitary reasons. I cleaned it up and threw it away. That jawbreaker was a medium, so it was quite big. I hopped up walked over to Billy and gently nudged him away from the rest of the jawbreakers. Some jawbreakers are absolutely massive and probably weighed more than Billy, so I was also doing it out of safety. Billy gave me a look in the eye, took in a deep breath, and shrieks in the store,
"Help!"
and bolted for Karen. I didn't really care, so long as he wasn't close to any other candy or the wall that was stocked with it. You can have kids in the candy store, but please watch them and teach them not to try and touch everything. I thought it was over and got up to sit back down at the cash register, but then Billy brought over his mother, Karen. Her hair screamed, "Give me the manager," and the way she looked at me, I'm pretty sure Karen was trying to stab me with her glares. Karen.
"Excuse me? You?"
I stared at Carmel, who she didn't look like she really wanted to get involved, and went into the back. If you are ever reading this, thanks Carmel for leaving me with a Karen. Me blinking. Me?
"Who else? How dare you grab my baby with your disgusting hands?"
I'm pretty sure if she spat any more, I could have taken a bath because of how much she was spitting. Me politely. "Ma'am, you must supervise him. He could get hurt." She stopped me with a hard glare. Karen, visibly turning red.
"Don't teach me how to raise my own kids, you jerk. Now, we deserve free candy to make up for what you've done."
She had a grin splitting across her face. I looked at the employee's door and begged that either Chad or Carmel could come in and help me. But no one came. Thanks, Chad. Thanks, Carmel. Me. "I can't just give you free candy, ma'am. You must pay for it. And besides, since you broke the medium-sized jawbreaker, you must pay to make up for it."
"What? I'm not paying for it. It's broken, and it was Billy who did it."
She was tapping her foot angrily, as if I was going to say, "Oh, of course, my bad. Let me not charge you for something your kid broke." In the store, you break it, it must be replaced. Even if it was your kid who broke it, you have to pay for the broken merchandise. Billy, literally screaming, even though he was not even 2 feet away from his mother.
"I want this!"
Pointing at our batch of peanut brittle. We make fresh, homemade peanut brittle. More like Chad makes them, and they were the best, honestly. On the container containing the brittle, a big sign said, "Warning, peanuts in product. Ask worker if you would like a sample and if you have any allergies." In big red letters, it even stated, "Peanuts in product." I think you know where this is going now. Karen.
"My son wants that for free. Give it to him."
Me. "Ma'am, I can't give it to you for free. You must pay for it. And before we can give it to you, we must know if the consumer has any allergies." Karen huffed and looked at the price. Then, with a dramatic gasp, reached in her bag for her wallet. The kid was putting his hands and face on the container the entire time. Me, very sweetly. "Billy, please get away from the glass." Billy.
"You aren't my mommy. You can't tell me what to do."
He tried knocking the glass lid to reach inside until I nudged him away. Billy, beginning to cry, looked at his mom with tears. Karen saw, and immediately she looked at me. Her face was twisted in a rage.
"You grabbed him again! Keep your hands to yourself!"
She was practically hissing at me as I wiped the glass container from all the gross drool and marks on it. Me, getting a bit frustrated. "I have asked him nicely to get away from the glass, ma'am." Before Karen could go off on me, Chad walked in with a fresh batch of homemade peanut brittle. Karen eye-scanned him, then she smiled all sweetly, as if she wasn't about to lose it on me. Karen.
"Sir?"
Chad, who was grabbing the old peanut brittle out the container.
"Yes, ma'am?"
"This lady,"
she glared at me,
"says I have to pay for a broken jawbreaker."
Chad, looking at me and Karen.
"What's going on, OP?"
I explained everything to him, telling Chad about the way the kid climbed our candy wall, broke the jawbreaker, touched the glass multiple times, and made a mess. I also told him I had to nudge him away so he wasn't in any danger. Chad understood and was glad I did that. One time, while Chad and Apple were here, a kid came in and wanted a jawbreaker. She tried to grab the biggest one, in which it rolled and fell on her hand. We have massive-sized ones, going well over $100. They were huge, but so good. So if Billy was to grab that, he could have easily gotten hurt. He got down on one knee and looked at Billy carefully, who was sniffling. Chad, would you like some peanut brittle? Billy, tears drying up.
Yes, please.
Me. Karen, is your kid allergic to anything? Like nuts, perhaps? She shrugged, and I stared at her stupidly. She doesn't even know what her kid was allergic to? Chad gave him a piece, though. I was hesitant and watched. Billy munched on it happily, and which Karen saw with a grin.
I'll be taking a 1/2-pound bag of peanut brittle, and I won't be paying for the jawbreaker Billy broke.
I gave Chad a look, so he looked back at me and shrugged. I was in the process of getting her the brittle when I heard small gasping noises. Billy, who was once white with bright eyes, had red eyes. His throat and face were swollen and red, and he looked like he was choking. Karen told him to actually shut up. Chad and I stared for a few seconds before calling an ambulance. I was on the phone with the operator as Chad tried getting closer to Billy. It sounded like he had some of the brittle stuck in his throat. Karen, huffing,
"He's fine. He's just being overdramatic. How much will the brittle be?"
I couldn't believe my ears at this. She was worried on the price? She was blocking Chad, who was desperately trying to help Billy. We weren't allowed to touch the customers unless something major was going on. And if they got the message that they weren't supposed to do that, we can gently nudge them away.
Chad flew past Karen, knocking her away as he reached for Billy, who looked to be barely breathing.
He then did the Heimlich maneuver, and sure enough, a piece of peanut brittle flew out of his body. Billy had had an allergic reaction. The operator on the phone told me they'll arrive extremely shortly, and which they did, not long after I hung up.
Karen was screaming at the cops and ambulance once they arrived, saying how Chad was aggressively shoving Billy.
Ambulance got him first, and luckily, Billy was okay. He was unconscious, and he was still incredibly swollen, but luckily, he was okay. The entire time, though, I was shaking. I never witnessed anything like that happen, and I hope I never see anything like that again. It was so scary seeing him gasp for air, all swollen and red. The police questioned Chad, who told basically everything. But Karen interjected a lot, saying he shoved me away from my kid as I tried to protect him. I stepped out and stood beside Chad, who I backed up on his story. Karen glared at me and was saying the same thing. Then a cop turned to us, away from the screaming Karen. Cop,
do you have any cameras? We can see what really happened on the footage.
When he uttered those words, Karen froze. Her skin turned pale and she was stuttering. Probably because we are all going to see how she neglected Billy and tried to stop Chad from helping him. But she didn't stop yelling and screaming at how me and Chad were going to get arrested. Before two cops walked into the back to check the footage, Carmel walked out and blinked. Cops questioned her before letting her go. Me and Chad didn't know that Carmel actually called our manager, that Ben was here too at the shop. Ben demanded to know what was going on, in which a cop and Chad explained, going into detail.
We heard Karen's yells, how Billy is going to be scarred forever because of this, when a cop finally told her to shut up.
The cop that went into the back and came back later, holding handcuffs. He handcuffed Karen and took her away. She was arrested for endangering Billy. Once Billy and Karen were taken away, Ben, our manager, asked if we were all okay. I said we were. Chad told his father, Ben, that I handled Karen and Billy very well when I quickly said all I did was call 911. Carmel apologized to me about leaving me alone to take care of Karen and her bratty kid. I said it was okay. She got a hold of our manager and did the right thing. Everything turned out well. Ben told us that there had been 3 or more people out doing the job. He congratulated us for saving Billy and exposing Karen. Honestly, even now, older, I still can't wrap my head around how she didn't even know that her kid was allergic to stuff. I know it wasn't Chad's fault for giving him the peanut brittle, but please, parents, know what your kids are allergic to. I never want to see that happen again. It was honestly terrifying. I just hope the kid is more behaved now and doing much better now than when he was with his mother, Karen. Is there anything that you're allergic to? Please leave me a comment right now letting me know. Next, we've got Entitled Mom Demands I Help Because I Apparently Work at a Trampoline Park. Backstory. This happened a while ago while I was at a birthday party, age 12.
My classmate was celebrating at a trampoline park, and my friends had began playing hide and seek with me, basically just hiding from me with no apparent reason. I started walking around to look for them when I got bored of it and went on my phone. There were plenty of other people there. Cue Karen and her spawn. Cast. We've got Karen. We've got spawn. We've got me. We've got friend. We've got nice employee, aka hero of the day. I was staring at my phone talking on Discord with some gaming friends when I suddenly heard a loud, ahem. I look up and the following conversation goes like this. Karen, what are you doing? You should be ashamed going on your phone while you're at work. The slushy machine is empty and I need you to refill it. Me.
Excuse me, but I don't... She interrupts me.
I don't care that you're on your break. Go refill the slushy machine now, or I will get your manager.
Mommy, I want the slushy.
Keep in mind, this dude was about 15 and acting like a baby.
I know, entitled kid. I'll get you your slush.
She now turns to me.
So, what are you waiting for? Go get him the slush.
I then laugh awkwardly, as I'm not good in social situations. Me. I'm sorry, but I don't work here. You're gonna have to talk to an employee about that.
That's BS. You're obviously an employee. You're even wearing the uniform.
The uniforms were orange and had the name of the company written in 3D in purple and gray paints. I was wearing black Adidas pants and a black hoodie with a white square on it, and inside the square was a man that looked like he was falling. Me. I do not. The uniforms are obviously orange and not black.
You still work here. There's a picture of a man jumping on your shirt. Now, go get us the slush. And because of the inconvenience, it should be free!
Karen then proceeds to drag me by my arm, and so I end up standing. Now just so you know, I was not very small then, not now either. At 12, I was about 175 centimeters tall, and I was pretty strong. So as you probably could tell, I was looking down at them both, as Karen was very small, and her son slightly taller than her. I also did not look like I was 12, and could easily pass for 16. She got caught a little bit off guard, but her face quickly turned. She whispered something to her son, and before I could figure out what was going on, they both threw themselves into the ground and started screaming.
Help! Help! This girl just attacked me and my son and stole his phone.
I was now cringing extremely because I hate being in the spotlight. So I was blushing hardcore at that point and putting on my hood, and everyone was staring at us. Friend then comes out of her hiding spot and rushes over to us. Friend, what are you doing? She's talking to the two idiots, by the way. She then stops and looks at me. Are they having a seizure? My friend and I have a weird type of humor. My friend also knows that I'm not good in social situations like this, so she stepped in front of me, even though she was a lot smaller than me. Karen.
This maniac swung at me and my son and stole his phone.
She screamed again. Friend rolled her eyes because she knows that even if I was one of the strongest people in school, I wouldn't have ever hurt anyone. Nice employee then comes over to see what's going on.
What's going on here? Are you okay, ma'am?
Karen, insert what she has said two times before.
Okay, calm down.
She looks at me.
Is this true, ma'am?
No, she came to me and claimed that I worked here. When I told her no, she threw herself on the ground and started screaming. Nice employee, looking a little skeptical because I looked kind of shady.
Okay, and is that your phone?
Yes, it is. I even have my fingerprint saved and I can unlock it by passcode too. Karen.
That's BS. She stole it and put her fingerprint in it.
Employee.
Okay, calm down. We can just go through the security cameras and see what happened.
Karen goes pale as a ghost.
Oh, I'm sure that's fine. We're about to be late for my son's soccer practice. I'll buy him a new phone.
She then grabbed her son's wrist and hurried out of the store. Nice employee apologized and gave me a free slush. It was filled again when I was about to leave from the party, and friend and I got a good laugh later. What's your favorite flavor of slushy? Please leave me a comment right now letting me know. Next we've got, you have the wrong number. A little backstory. Blue Cross Blue Shield, or whatever health insurance company American Airlines has, is apparently the same phone number as my company, but just the area code is different. So I've been getting a lot of wrong number calls at work. I usually just interrupt people and tell them they have the wrong number, and
and hang up without waiting for a response. And that's that. I try to be as nice as possible. But a few times, people have called back. This story is about one of my favorite times. We've got me. We've got Angry Lady. This story is from before I knew what the phone number differences were or what the insurance company was. Phone rings. Me. Company name. How may I help you? Karen.
My husband is the pilot with American Airlines, and I'm in the doctor's office right now.
Me. Are you looking for an insurance company?
Yeah,
I'm sorry, ma'am. You have the wrong number. We're not your insurance company, okay? Have a nice day. Hangs up. Phone rings. Me. Company name. How may I help you? Karen. Clearly mad, but not yet yelling.
Since you so rudely hung up on me, do you think you could give me the correct number to call?
Me. No, I don't have the number to your insurance company. Try redialing. Hangs up. Phone rings. Me. Company name. How may I...
How dare you hang up on me?
Me. Hangs up. Phone rings. Now I see it's her number, and I'm kind of bored. So I decide to let her go off for a minute this time, just for fun. But I let it ring a few times, and then pick it up. Company name. How may I help you?
Karen. Incredibly angry. Are you kidding me? Listen here, Miss Company Name. Hang up on me again and you're fired. My husband is a pilot for American Airlines. Connect me to the insurance. Now!
Me. I can't. I don't have that number and I don't work with them. But can I interest you in our new product? We have the best prices.
What is wrong with you? I'm going to have you fired. My husband is a...
I hang up. I hang up while she's still yelling. She called back one more time and I didn't answer, and she hasn't called back since. I guess she figured it out. I feel bad for whoever caught her when she did dial the right number, and I really hope someone isn't actually named what our store is named at Blue Cross or American. Next we've got, my house shares a similar address to a local retail store. I moved to a small countryside town a couple of years ago. I live on a road with a dead end for traffic that has a walkthrough to the local shops and a small shopping precinct. The precinct starts across the road from the end of the walkthrough. The shops on the precinct are numbered 1 through 20, as it's not very large. There are only a handful of houses on my road, so again, we have small numbers associated with our address. So my number reads 5, my street name, town, local postcode. The precinct store reads 5, the precinct name, my street name, town, and the same local postcode. On a few occasions, it's become apparent that people have just put in the street name and the postcode when looking for the store. Their satellite navigation has then brought them to my road, and they have looked for, I guess, number 5. Normally, when I get a knock at the door, I explain to the store's customer and point them in the right direction. There's a small car park for the precinct. They often apologize, and some even feel embarrassed. One day, around 6 months ago, I get a Karen. My front door pops loudly. I wonder who could be making such a racket. I open the front door to see a lady around her mid-40s, very well-dressed, the very well-pampered type. Karen.
I've come to pick up my balloons.
Me. Oh, are you looking for the store? It's in the shopping center. There's no way through by car. Let me give you directions.
Karen. Hang on a minute. My satellite navigation said this is the address.
She's holding up her phone with Google Maps. Yeah, that happens a lot. However, your satellite navigation is wrong, and the shop is in the precinct.
My satellite navigation is not wrong. I'm in far too much of a hurry for this. I would like you to stop messing around and get my paid-for balloons.
Me. Sorry, but I'm a private home, not a business. Bye. I shut the door, and Karen proceeds to start knocking my knocker again and demanding I answer the door. After a few minutes, she stormed off, and I could see through the window she was talking angrily on her phone and walked off down the road towards the walkthrough, leaving her car in my driveway, blocking my own car in. Around an hour later, she returned with her balloons and other shopping bags, got in her car, and left. A couple of days later, I went into the store to talk to the owner about it, if it was a possibility to email customers when they purchase online regarding their address situation, as I was a little annoyed by Karen. When I explained about Karen, the owner said she knew exactly who I meant. Karen had called the store and had ranted at them the whole time the owner was giving her directions to the store. When Karen had got to the store, she had ranted how I had wasted her time and been rude to her, and how the store needed better customer service. I'm in the UK, so a shopping precinct is, I guess you could call it, an open-air shopping mall, as it's not enclosed as such, and is a lot smaller.
And shoutouts to our regenerals of the day, Foxy Foxy, Yuyun Lee, Anne Swan, and Evis Van. Become tomorrow's regenerals by leaving as many rees as you can in the comments below. And please listen to my playlist every night when you go to sleep.